was the exciting conclusion of my spherical trigonometry trilogy. In this video, I want to talk about how spherical trigonometry is used for celestial and, in general, terrestrial navigation. We should start out by acknowledging that the Earth is not a perfect sphere. Because of its rotation, it's slightly wider at the equator, but the difference is only about 0.33%, which is rounder than your average cue ball. So for our purposes, we're going to treat it as if it's an exact sphere. The face of the Earth is a 2D surface, and as such requires two values to specify a unique location. We accomplish this by creating a grid structure using latitude and longitude, sometimes called geographic positions. We'll measure distances along great circle arcs, that is, arcs whose center is the center of the Earth. Longitude is an angle measured around the central axis connecting the north and south poles. Longitude lines, which are also called meridians, are all great circles that go through both poles. The zero position is the longitude line going through the Royal Observatory in Greenwich, England. This is referred to as the prime meridian. Viewing Earth from a point above the North Pole, longitude is measured clockwise to the west of the prime meridian and counterclockwise to the east. Both directions measure from 0 to 180 degrees, round to the half circle opposite the prime meridian called the antimeridian. Longitude requires that we specify east or west as part of its measure. Latitude is measured by the angle between the plane containing the equator and a line segment joining the center of the Earth to your position. Lines of equal latitude are called parallels because they form circles parallel to the equator. Zero is chosen to be along the equator, and we measure 0 to 90 degrees to the north and south of the equator, with 90 degrees being at the poles. Latitude requires we specify north or south as part of its measure. Putting these together, we get a grid system that surrounds the Earth. You can see here where we specify the location of New Orleans in America as having a longitude 90 degrees west of the prime meridian and a latitude 30 degrees north of the equator. We don't need to state which is latitude and longitude since it's implied by the east-west or north-south attached to the measure. The other standard we'll use in this video is nautical miles for distance. Nautical miles are based on measuring distance along an arc of a great circle. A great circle arc which measures 1 minute will have an arc length of 1 nautical mile, or equivalently, an arc which measures 1 degree will have an arc length of 60 nautical miles. A nautical mile is slightly larger than a statute mile and nearly twice the length of a kilometer. Suppose we're given the distance from Melbourne, Florida to the North Pole, given it's located at latitude 28.08 degrees north. 28.08 is the measure from Melbourne down to the equator, so 90 minus 28.08 equals 61.92 degrees is the measure heading due north along the meridian line to the North Pole. The angle is called the co-latitude, co as in complementary angle. But this means the length of the arc in nautical miles is just 60 times the degree measure of the arc. Hence, 60 times 61.92 equals a distance of 3,715.2 nautical miles. On the other hand, or other hemisphere, if we wanted to find the distance from Melbourne, Australia, at latitude 37.81 degrees south, going to the North Pole, we would now have a co-latitude of 90.37.81 equals 127.81 degrees of arc. So a distance of 127.81 times 60 equals 7,668.6 nautical miles. So now let's start looking at the stars. Stars are very far away, very, very far away. Other than the Sun, our nearest star, Proxima Centauri, is about 25 trillion miles from Earth. As a result of this great distance, if two people were on opposite sides of the Earth pointing at the same star, the angle between their arms would be about 0.00000181 degrees. So for purposes of calculation, we're going to assume that all lines pointing to the same star are parallel. This does not mean that the star will appear to be in the same position for everyone. The tangent to the terrestrial sphere at your location defines what we perceive as the horizon, and the star will appear to be making different angles with the horizon depending on your location. The angle that the star makes with the horizon is called the altitude, and it's usually denoted with an H or HO for observed height. Even if you do not move, the Earth does, so the altitude will change throughout the night as the star appears to move like the Sun and Moon, rising in the east and setting in the west. So when we measure altitude, we need to record the time. A point directly overhead is called our zenith, and the line connecting the center of the Earth and our position is called our zenith axis. Note that the zenith axis is perpendicular to our horizon plane. The point directly below a star on the face of the Earth is called the ground position of the star, usually denoted GP. If you were at this location, the star would be exactly at your zenith. So your zenith axis here would point directly at the star. Like altitude, the ground position changes as the Earth rotates. Notice the closer a person is to the ground position, the higher the altitude above the horizon. Now we get an important result. Suppose we let C be the center of the Earth. Call our position O for observer, and HO is the altitude of a star. Then 90 minus HO is the angle between the star and our zenith axis, CO. This is called the co-altitude. But since we're assuming our altitude line to the star is parallel to the line going through GP of the star, this means that the co-altitude is the corresponding angle with the angle OCGP, which is the measure of the great circle arc connecting our position O to the GP of the star. So we can find the distance from our position to the GP in nautical miles by simply multiplying the co-altitude by 60. Knowing the date and time we observe the star, we can look in a sight reduction table to find the latitude and longitude of its ground position. I'll save the math involved in calculating this for a future video. Then knowing the GP of a particular star and our distance d to the GP, we know that we are located somewhere on a circle of radius d with center at the ground position. Taking a sighting from a second star, we get another circle, and of course we can take a third if needed to fix our position. So this is what happens in theory. In practice, the GP of the star is usually way off our chart, and we're zoomed in so close that our circle around the GP just looks like a little line segment. This line segment is called a line of position, and we assume we're located somewhere on or near this line. By getting a line of position from other stars, we can find some point central to where they intersect and take this as our fixed position. Now let's start pulling all this together. We can start with the idea of dead reckoning. This is basically estimating your position from some previous past position. If you're driving your car and see a major road, then you know where you are. If you drive past this at 60 miles per hour for half an hour, you'd expect to be 30 miles away. In the ocean or in the air, it's a more difficult problem, and lots of factors can throw off your calculation, like wind or waves causing leeway and the accuracy of your measuring devices. Still, it's helpful to have at least a rough idea of your location. Consider this problem. A plane leaves Miami, Florida on an initial bearing 60 degrees east of due north, flying along a great circle arc path. Given the latitude and longitude shown here for Miami, what would be the approximate new latitude and longitude if the plane is flying at 150 nautical miles per hour for 2 hours? We start by making a spherical triangle with one vertex at Miami, one vertex at the North Pole, denoted NP here, and one representing our position P after 2 hours. The North Pole is usually our go-to top vertex point because side measures are just co-latitudes and the angle at the pole is just the change in longitude. Because Miami has a latitude of 25.76, then the measure of the side joining Miami to the North Pole is just the co-latitude, 90 minus 25.76 equals 64.24 degrees. The vertex angle at Miami is our initial bearing since it's measured relative to due north. And finally, we can calculate the distance from Miami to P as 2 hours times 150 nautical miles per hour equals 300 nautical miles. And now dividing 300 by 60, we see that this corresponds to a great circle arc of 5 degrees. Now we have a side angle side case with all the information at the vertex for Miami. Using the spherical law of cosines, we can calculate the measure of the opposite side labeled LC for co-latitude. We have the cosine of LC equals the cosine of 5, cosine 64.24 plus sine 5, sine 64.24 times cosine of 60. So cosine of LC equals 0.47219, which gives us LC equals 61.82 degrees. Side LC is just the co-latitude for our new position. So our new latitude should be 90 minus 61.82 equals 28.17 degrees north of the equator. Now we have the vertex at Miami and the measure of the opposite side, so we can use our law of sines to find the measure of our angle at the pole. I label this angle delta L because it represents our change in longitude. From the law of sines, we get the sine of delta L over the sine of 5 equals sine of 60 over sine of 61.82. Solving this, we see that sine of delta L equals 0.08563, hence delta L equals 4.91 degrees. Our old longitude for Miami was 80.19, and we have now rotated easterly 4.91 degrees, so our new longitude is 80.19 minus 4.91 equals 75.28 degrees west. You may have noticed we mentioned our initial bearing was 60 degrees. Following a great circle arc, our bearing will change. If we were to maintain a steady bearing of 60 degrees, we would be following a curve called a run line or a loxodrome. This is easier for navigators to follow, but it's not the shortest great circle path on a sphere. Another common problem is finding the distance between two locations. We know their geographic position for both. That is, their latitudes and longitudes. In this example, we have the geographic position for Seattle, Washington, and Honolulu, Hawaii. What would be the great circle distance between them? Once again, we make a spherical triangle with one point at Honolulu, one at Seattle, and one at the North Pole. The side joining Honolulu to NP is just the co-latitude, 68.7 degrees. Likewise, the side joining Seattle to NP is its co-latitude, 42.4 degrees. The angle at the pole will just be the difference in longitude for the two sides. That is 157.68 minus 122.33 equals 35.53 degrees. Now we have all the information at the vertex NP, we can use our law of cosines to find side little d. We get cosine d equals cosine 42.4 cosine 68.7 plus sine 42.4 sine 68.7 cosine 35.53. So cosine of d equals 0.7795 and d equals 38.7838 degrees. Converting this arc measure to nautical miles, we get the distance from Seattle to Honolulu is 60 times 38.7838. equals 2,327.03 nautical miles. Notice that we now have all three sides for our spherical triangle, so we can also calculate the angle that is the initial bearing if we are departing from, say, Seattle. Using our law of cosines, again, we get cosine of theta equals negative 0.502955, so theta equals 120.19 degrees west of north. We could have also used our spherical law of sines, but we would have to be careful. Since our angle is clearly more than 90 degrees, we would have gotten the reference angle. So let's finish up by talking about what's called the intersect method. This uses both the previous methods to help navigators improve their line of position calculation. Suppose you're sailing, but have had a few cloudy days. Since you could not take a star sight, you've been estimating your position by dead reckoning. So you have an estimate for your location, which we will call our assumed position, or AP. We finally have a clear evening, so we want to fix our position. We find the altitude of a star, call this HO for our observed altitude, and record the time. Now we look at our manuals to find the latitude and longitude of the ground position of our star at the time we took our sighting. We now have a rough spherical triangle like the one shown here. Values we derive for this triangle will be called computed values because they're based on an AP computed by dead reckoning. We know the geographical positions of AP and GP. Using the same method as our last example, connecting Seattle and Honolulu, we can find the arc measure of the side DC connecting our assumed position to the ground position, and also the bearing angle at our vertex AP. Using the bearing angle, we can draw a line on our chart from our AP towards the GP. Our line of position should be perpendicular to this line, and for the moment, we can assume that this is perpendicular at our assumed position. Now we go back and look at our observed altitude HO. The co-altitude tells us the arc measure from our actual position to the GP. So let DO be our observed distance. DO equals 90 minus HO is the value for our actual arc length to the GP. If our observed distance is less than DC, the arc length we computed from AP to GP, then we're actually closer to the GP. If DO is greater than DC, we're further away. The difference between DO and DC tells us the arc difference, which we can then multiply by 60 to get the nautical mile difference. In the example shown here, our computed arc measure was 50.1 degrees, but our observed arc measure was 49.8. Because DO is less than DC, This means we're actually closer to the GP than our AP. Since the difference in the arc is 0.3 degrees, this corresponds to a distance of 60 times 0.3 equals 18 nautical miles. So we need to move our perpendicular line to position 18 nautical miles closer to the GP along our line pointing to the GP. This is our corrected line of position based off of our observed altitude. Now you just have to repeat this process for two more stars, and you'll have a fix for your current location. Then knowing your new fixed location, you can find the distance and bearing to your final destination. So sure, this sounds like a lot of work, but you're out in the middle of the ocean, so you have a lot of free time on your hands. This should be enough to get you started with spherical terrestrial navigation. I hope you found this video helpful. You can see more of my math videos at www.mathforeveryone.info. Please feel free to leave comments and suggestions, and thanks for watching.